This is Duke University.
It's a familiar impulse. You step into a room full of strangers. You sit down at a bar to meet your date. You're in the middle of an argument, and the other person is now refusing to talk. You feel vulnerable, and you want to know, what are they thinking? It's not always an appropriate question to ask, and sometimes, but not always, you adhere to the regime of propriety, so you start searching faces instead. There can be very little to go on. You take on the posture of a detective, and you want to investigate, and you want to know. Each twitch turns into a clue, each flare an implication. But the tangle dear to scientists, historians, acting coaches, painters, and writers alike is whether we can reliably determine something akin to information from looking at and searching faces. How much and how effectively and to what extent do our faces act like any other medium of communication? In what ways can we think of the face as a medium at all, as simply material through which we express? Unlike paint, words, or a photograph, the face is not a material substance or a form per se, although it shares with mediums the sense that emotions and ideas move through it, that it is a recognizable set of features which, in relation to one another, become a face. But faces, unlike other mediums, are also the product of genetic expressions, some inherited, some idiosyncratic. Our faces are sets and products of organic materials and chemical reactions. More, our facial expressions happen through physiological processes like muscular contractions, sometimes outside our explicit control. If we take the biological reality of the face into account, to read faces as mediums of expression is already to contend that the idea of expression is not merely a question of intention, but is inextricably linked to the reception of what may or may not have been intended. We can twitch, squint, or smirk, and mean nothing by it at all. In the larger chapter from which I take this talk, I explore how the photographic promise to capture and isolate an instant shaped understandings of habitual facial expressions in the 19th century. I say habitual expressions to distinguish the facial expressions under scrutiny here from either accidental or idiosyncratic ones. It was photography that first took me into the history of studying, reading, and obsessing over the meaning of the human face. I quickly saw that an important part of the history of understanding the human face as a medium of expression has meant further mediation. Before photography, artists and scientists alike used drawing, painting, engraving, to name only a few, to represent and thereby study the face. In the chapter, I look at two studies of facial expressions that deployed photographs, G.B. Duchenne's mechanism of human facial expression, and Charles Darwin's expressions of emotion in man and animal. I locate both of these studies within ongoing debates about muscular contractions, reflexes, and the nervous system. My analysis shows how photographic mapping helped along a historical reinterpretation of what kind of evidence facial expressions constituted, of spirit, of passions, of will, of habituation, of culture, in relation, crucially, to time. What happens when scientists begin to use photography to study and understand the expressions we make or don't mean to make with our faces, I argue, is that photography brings forward the fiction of being able to stop and capture a single instant of expression, the fiction of the existence of a single instant, theorists of time might add. By making this kind of argument, I cut against the grain of the idea that the use of photography in scientific studies was and is entirely about creating the illusion of objectivity. Instead, I ask how the idea of instantaneity inflects differently in these two 19th century studies. What I mean is that there are at least two different notions of what an instant of photography is. More, the scientific attention to the instant in the middle of the 19th century should recall at least the intertwined histories of statistics, archival practices, criminology, and geographical studies of the American West, facilitated by the evolving technologies of photography. By focusing on instants, I want to move away both from accounts of photography's ability to call attention to detail and away from the idea of a photograph as solely an object of revelation. Art historian Philip Prodger notes that it was when photographs began to push into spheres beyond the limits of human vision, for example, rapid actions that happened too quickly for the naked eye to track, that photography came to assume a privileged place in the visual realm. The photograph might have appeared to reveal, but it also, crucially, constructed ways of seeing and thinking, especially about the human face. Today I will show how a specific understanding of the photographic instant shaped what counted as a detail for a quirky French medic named Duchenne, leaving the famed English naturalist for another day. The instants I'm interested in are not those that revealed clues. Instead, I'm trying to understand how his notion of instantaneity shaped what he could conceive of as a clue about the nature of emotional expressions. Finally, this paper bears on the afterlife of Duchenne's techniques in the work of those who still use images of faces as stimuli to understand both the occurrence and the perception of our emotional worlds on our faces. So, to give you an idea of how we'll be spending the next 30 minutes, first, I'll take us into the world of G.B. Duchenne and situate him in a centuries-old trajectory of thinking about the human face and its expressions. Having done that, I'll explain how Duchenne sought to differentiate his work from others and the key role that photography played in allowing him to do so. Third, I want to isolate that it is his particular way of understanding photographic form that makes the conceptual difference in his work. And all of this work, ultimately, hopefully, gets us a bit closer to the long history of the vulnerability and thrill, the particular terror and delight of never quite and not entirely having complete access to the emotional worlds of even the people whom we love. G.B. Duchenne was a French physician with an interest in rare muscular disorders. In the late 1840s and 50s, he began to make a name for himself in Paris using a process he called local ferretization. With it, he applied an electric current to individual muscles in order to rehabilitate them and thereby restore movement. In addition, he used the portable electric device to isolate individual muscular contractions and the interaction of muscles with one another to functionally map all bodily muscles and to study their coordinating action in health and in disease. André Perrin explains that before Duchenne's work to map muscles, it was generally believed that during voluntary movements, agonist muscles contracted themselves, whereas antagonist muscles remained inactive. However, Duchenne showed experimentally that any movements of the extremities or the trunk were the result of a double nervous excitation whereby muscles that exerted an opposite action contracted simultaneously, some to produce the movement and others to modulate it. Duchenne meted out precisely how types of muscles interacted during voluntary movement by applying electric currents to various muscles. This insight into the cooperation between agonist and antagonist muscles changed accepted ideas about what made muscular movement possible. Even during a voluntary movement, there were always accompanying involuntary movements that helped dictate at what speed and in what direction a movement occurred. Duchenne was responsible, in part, for mapping which and how each muscle was associated with each part of the process. But the implications of his method and discoveries would take on new meaning when he became interested in faces. Duchenne first became interested in photography while working on patients in Paris with local ferretization, about the time he began to think about facial expressions. He first thought the new technology would be a way for him to document the various cases of muscular disorders he encountered in Paris hospitals. He teamed up with and even employed Nadar's younger brother to learn the wet collodion process. Popularized in the 1850s, the wet collodion process facilitated the production of multiple prints from a single and usually glass plate negative. Equipped now with the ability to take his own photographs, Duchenne turned his attentions to how muscles contracted on faces. It would be a misreading of Duchenne to shrink his interest, though, to merely the contraction of muscles. This anatomical drawing helps highlight the nexus of aesthetic, scientific, and metaphysical questions into which his examination of facial expressions intervened. The source of this image, Duchenne's The Mechanism of Human Facial Expression, set out to map facial expressions of emotion according to the muscles that contracted to create them. Like other anatomical illustrations, this one promises to reveal what lies underneath skin. It becomes properly anatomical by losing particularities. I want to note that it is the skin that has disappeared through its absence that is meant to be perfectly metonymic of all skin and every person. Clusters of muscle tissue are arranged in distinct patterns, like neat interlocking roads and alleyways. The shaded flesh of the lips and the thick fibrous muscle tissue creates the illusion of softness, but here there are no fluids. This is not a body. This is a body with no blood. Curiously, but again, like other anatomical drawings, this one preserved traces of skin on half of the forehead and scalp, in the tip of the nose, closed eyelids, in the cartilage of the ears, in the flesh of the lips. If this representation and those like it expose what functions underneath skin, why did some skin remain? The drawing and its legend appeared with Duchenne's explanations of his anatomical preparations and of the photographic portraits of each of his subjects. The letter that marked each muscle in the drawing corresponded not only to the name of the muscle, as we might expect of an anatomical illustration, but also to an emotion that the muscle produced for sight. This letter G in the drawing, for example, referred to the muscle of crying. Before photography promised to mechanically isolate them, small, even involuntary movements, postures, attitudes, and facial expressions were thought of as the evidence of a person's spirit. Duchenne drew on a long history of philosophers, scientists, and artists who variously encountered, described, and studied facial expressions as evidence of a person's soul. Facial expressions were thought to be a pre-linguistic repository for the communication of our spiritual essences, in addition to markers of our emotional states. So that perhaps while muscles and nerve endings evoked the physiological in the drawing, skin and cartilage suggested the person and personality who existed and expressed beyond the delineation of fibers and tissues. Artists had also long asserted the importance of expressions like those Duchenne sought to isolate with a camera. Painter Charles Le Brun, who had studied with Descartes, put the importance of expressions to painters this way. Expression, in my opinion, is a simple and natural image of the thing we wish to represent. It is a necessary ingredient of all the parts of painting, and without it, no picture can be perfect. It is this which indicates the true character of each object. It is by this means that different natures of bodies are distinguished, that figures seem to have movement, and everything which is imitated appears to be real. For Le Brun, an expression both preceded painting and was constitutive of it. It was inherent in the object being represented, and it was also that which only a successful painter could render. An expression evoked an essence. An expression was the visible proof that an essence existed beyond sight. An artist was distinguished precisely by her ability to recognize, extract, and paint authentic expressions, and expressions were produced primarily by movement. But Le Brun was not interested in the laws of motion as Duchenne was. Duchenne thought he could locate these laws and turn them into what he called an orthography through photography. If a face could potentially outpace the will to reveal a spiritual essence that only a true artist could recognize and render, a face would not be able to outrun the camera. Building on inquiries into the relationship between emotional experience and emotional expression, 18th century physiognomic studies by David Hartley and Johann Caspar Lavater, precursors to Duchenne, did not posit that only artists could properly detect and render expressions. Instead, they drew attention to the structural causes of the movements. These studies constituted an early science of mind that was designed to reveal the moral order, instead of focusing on artists' privileged rendering of expressions. Hartley was the first, in fact, to use the word psychology in the modern sense. In Joseph Roach's telling, Hartley proposed a model of mind that sought to bring together mind and body in an integrated system which was regulated solely by vibrations and associations, primarily those of the sensory apparatus. These later studies analyzed a wider array of movements that could not easily be characterized as either voluntary or involuntary. For example, in Observations on Man, Hartley studied patterns of movement that could be performed mechanically, in the sense that someone who was not entirely conscious could perform them. He called these secondary automatic motions. Secondary automatic motions were movement a person first acquired through habit that had been consciously performed but no longer needed active attention in order to be performed. They differed from the automatism of the heartbeat, which is also not a conscious action, thankfully, I think. Broadly, Hartley's text and interest in automatism signaled a shift in interest from the ways in which the soul became visible as expression to the ways in which expressions worked at the level of physiology. When considering the relationship between faces, ideas of personhood and identity, and the reading practices for facial expressions forged through visual culture, scholars have more often considered the inheritance of physiognomy rather than a physiology. Alan Sekulow's seminal essay, The Body and the Archive, was crucial in synthesizing photographic practices to epistemologies that held racialized and criminalized bodies captive in line with physiognomy's cultural inheritance. physiognomic principles self-identified as reading practices of human morphology, where the physiological studies that arose alongside and persisted after them aspired to and espoused empirical description rather than interpretive models. Physiological studies aimed to be descriptions of biological realities. But unlike physiology, physiognomy sought the meaning of expressions rather than their physical causes. Historian Julia Voss describes the goal of physiognomy as making the human visage legible so that the nose, eyes, mouth, and cheeks would reveal the character of the owner. The meaning of the given expression could always supersede intention. It was in this capacity to portray intention that one's expressions were understood to expose the soul. The physiognomic studies were concerned less with the movement that produced facial expressions and much more with the structures of faces, the height of a forehead, the width of a cheek, the curve of a chin, the distance between eyes. As Sekula put it, physiognomy analytically isolated the profile of the head and the various anatomic features of the head and face, assigning a characterological significance to each element, forehead, eyes, ears, nose, chin. Individual character was judged through the loose concatenation of these readings. In both its analytical and synthetic stages, this interpretive process required that distinctive individual features be read in conformity to type. For Sekula, studies like Lavater's and the racist science of the phrenologist who followed his work each contributed to a medicalized study of the self, what Jane Thrakill has most recently termed a forensics of self. Sekula called their contribution to science a materialist science of self. Any distinctive features were to be read only in conformity to type. What he criticizes here is not just the imbalance of power between scientific knowledge and subject, although that mattered deeply, but the sacrifice of individuation in favor of types that created and sustained the authority of science. These disciplines, Sekula further argued, would serve to legitimate the dominion of intellectual over manual labor. Thus, physiognomy and phrenology contributed to the ideological hegemony of a capitalism that increasingly relied upon a hierarchical division of labor, a capitalism that applauded its own progress as the outcome of individual cleverness and cunning. Sekula's influential thesis gave scholars a way of joining photographic practices, the history of science to political economy. What I want to ask instead is how photography helped shape understandings of facial expressions in conversation with reading for various kinds of typologies, but which also made room for the individual. Duchenne's study, then, of the laws that covered facial expressions was at the intersection of physiognomy's concern with structure, physiology's investigations of the workings and mappings of muscular movements, and photographic studies of movement and time, like those of Murray and Muybridge later in the century. Studies by the likes of Sir Charles Bell and Herbert Spencer informed Duchenne's ideas about the involuntariness within voluntary movement. Bell offered a fairly structuralist account for how expressions came to be expressed. He proposed that the structures made them necessary. Studies like Bell's slowly began to replace the idea of mind as a spiritual essence of a supernatural order with a physicalist conception of mental states. What continued to be at stake was the participation of the soul, along with the consciousness and the will. Physiognomy had preempted moments that betrayed attention by naming those as revelatory of character. Physiological studies, meanwhile, considered what caused muscles to move and challenged the certainty that undergirded physiognomy that what bodies expressed were those characteristics of a soul. From the provenance of artists, where what mattered was the capacity to discern from above, facial expressions became evidence of biological structures and pathways, that is, of activity from below. For Bell, the question of structure sidestepped the need to attribute movement to either volition or spirit. For Spencer, who influenced Duchenne, every emotional expression was a failure of control. Spencer reached this conclusion by identifying all expressions as excesses of nerve force. The overflow of nerve force at once produced the state we call feeling and liberated violent movements. These studies then reoriented the kind of evidence facial expressions comprise by asking structural questions about what happens below skin. Instead of emphasizing what an expression revealed, these studies investigated what caused them to occur. They helped shape a new understanding of expressions not as secrets about a person, but as related to the habits of muscles in addition to the structure of the face. That Duchenne drew on these physicalist frameworks did not, however, do away with his belief in the presence of a soul. It's part of what's sort of delightful about his book. What was different for Duchenne was the purview he allowed to the soul in his study. The epigraph that precedes the first section of his book, paired with Duchenne's opening sentences, elucidates the distinction. The epigraph reads, "When the spirit is roused, the human face becomes a living picture, where the emotions are registered with much delicacy and energy, where each movement of the spirit is expressed by a feature, each action by a characteristic, the swift, sharp impression of which anticipates the will and discloses our most secret feelings." So that will sound familiar to all the work that I've just talked about. For Buffon, each movement and each action was evidence of the movement of the spirit when roused. The swift, sharp impression of each feature anticipated the will and disclosed our most secret feelings. This kind of reading practice was endemic to physiognomic studies. But just after the epigraph, Duchenne introduced his text this way. "The spirit is thus the source of expression. It activates the muscles that portray our emotions on the face with characteristic patterns. Consequently, the laws that govern the expressions of the human face can be discovered by studying muscle action." Duchenne situated his study as proceeding from Buffon's, "The spirit is thus the source of expression," but his gloss on Buffon was already more mechanistic than Buffon's account. The correlation for him between spirit and movement was how invisible souls became visible evidence. Duchenne translated what the soul did from registering on the face as the soul's evidence to activating characteristic patterns. The difference matters. Duchenne was not articulating a system for the meaning or taxonomy of how a soul appears. He sought to discover and chart the laws that govern the expressions. The soul was present for Duchenne, but only as part of the process he sought to map by using electric nodes on his subject's faces. Facial expressions were a kind of evidence for him, but not of the soul or its characteristics. Rather, the soul for Duchenne made evident the laws and patterns which he sought to use photography to discover. The structure of mechanism of human facial expressions reveals the twinned inheritance of artistic and scientific discussions from which Duchenne drew, as well as the dual audiences he imagined his study would reach. First, there are three parts to the study. The first section stated the study's aims, reviewed previous studies, gave an overview of his findings, and the implications for psychology, painting, and sculpture. That will sound really familiar to anyone who's ever written anything academic. Duchenne outlined his preparations, included several anatomical illustrations like those with which we began, and introduced the portraits of each of his subjects. I always feel sort of dramatic when this part happens, because there's him, and her, and him. Each subsequent chapter isolated either one muscle, I'll come back to them in a second, don't worry. Each subsequent chapter isolated either one muscle, as in the case of chapter 7, dedicated to the muscle of reflection, or a combination of muscles, as in chapter 13, dedicated to the muscles of weeping and whimpering. Whoa. Chapters began with a discussion of the photographic plates that displayed the appropriate muscular contraction and its corresponding emotion. In the last of the three sections, what he called the aesthetic section, and it was added afterwards. Duchenne envisioned each photographic plate not only as a particular emotional expression, but as a moment in a fictional narrative, namely Macbeth. Yes. The editors of the English translation note that since the text was published serially, each subsequent section addressed critics concerned to those that had already been published. So one criticism that he was addressing is that he was the only subject used in the first iteration of the text, and those who saw the images at the academy thought he was too ugly. So, this guy, and her, and her, and him. I don't know why he added him, but so, that was mean. By the printing of the third section, in answer to the objections that the cobbler wasn't attractive, Duchenne added a younger and handsome man, two women, and the young girl we saw previously. Duchenne studied and demarcated then how muscles were attached to one another, the angles at which folds or wrinkles in the skin happened, and the effect of muscular contractions at the level of the skin. He painstakingly described each curve in the face as it happened, including those that were voluntary or not caused by his electrodes, variations in one half and the other when there are different muscles being stimulated by the electrodes. For example, in chapter 13, which looked at the muscles of weeping and whimpering, he wrote, in relation to these photographs, The ala of the nose is elevated and has dragged the superior extremity of the nasolabial fold with it. This fold is less oblique and therefore elongated, and the lateral portion of the upper lip is pulled upward. Can you see that? He differentiated between fundamental and secondary lines of expression and explored reasons there could be variations across subjects. Sometimes he interpreted some parts of the face dragging others, as in the description I just read, but he didn't consider that other muscles were moving as well, since he had not contracted them. Those didn't count, even if they moved and were captured by the photograph. Duchenne entered into great detail about the subtleties of the emotions discernible in each photographic plate. In chapter 15, for example, dedicated to the muscle of fright, of terror, Duchenne deemed his photographs particularly successful at demonstrating proof that M. platysma was the muscle of terror. The cobbler was Duchenne. Ah, I said that already. The reason that he used the cobbler was because not only was he middle-aged, that's actually not the reason, because he suffered from facial neuralgia. So he thought that he could use his electric probes without causing him pain, unlike his other subjects. Duchenne identified this expression as fright. Here, the electricity from the nose on his forehead furrowed the brow as in moments of concern. Those at either side of his neck have pulled his jaw down and back, wrinkling his neck down the length of his throat. To expose how far the wrinkles extend, his shirt collar has been opened wide. Can y'all see that? Come. As in other images, the cobbler's thin, stringy strands of hair confirm his objection. The small patch of hair atop his head, where he has yet to bald, stands on its end, electrocuted to attention. To look closely at his images is to begin to see more clearly the disjoint, though, between how Duchenne understood his photographs and the photographs themselves. That disconnect helps us locate his understanding of photographic form as a kind of instant. Part of that is because I think it remains an open question whether this is an image of fright, despite Duchenne's confident designation and description. The image suggests instead that muscles have a memory to contract in ways that become legible as expressions of emotion rather than depicting an emotional expression itself. Lebrun might even wince at the image above and beyond the cobbler's ugliness. Expression was supposed to be for him, remember, the particular provenance of artists to discern. He might have identified a certain hubris in Duchenne in positing that electricity could yield to a layman's vision what an artist had been revered for being able to see. Even physiologists like Bell might have objected that this causing of lines on a cobbler's face was useful for studying the processes by which an expression occurred. Physiognomists like Lavater even more explicitly would balk at the radical mechanization of expressions and faces in these images. It is easy to imagine that he would have seen these as entirely bereft of spirit. The wonderment of Duchenne's text is that Duchenne instead thought he was satisfying each of these inheritances in turn. The precision he sought in representing facial expressions by using electrophoretization along with photography recalls, for one, Frederick Taylor's late 19th century innovation to industrial production, scientific management, or Taylorism. Marianne Doan describes the ways in which Taylorism isolated the crucial gestures of a worker, calculated how they could be most efficiently performed, and timed them with a stopwatch, incentives that encouraged workers in a given factory to adopt the most efficient gestures, which then became routinized, reducing the time of a particular operation to a bare minimum. Duchenne similarly called for efficiency in the representation of emotions, and this project was in part to satisfy that call. His aspiration toward efficiency rendered the face not only mechanized from within, but also mathematized from above. The images of his mechanized subjects operated in relation to images of the subjects' faces at rest, which we saw at the beginning. He included those images of expressionlessness, and in so doing proposed that the facial coordinates of any person's facial features were plotted as though on an XY axis, where the at rest position was analogous to the coordinates 0, 0. Expressions in this view were deviations from the fact of repose. Dance historian Susan Lee Foster describes how 19th century dance instructor Benoît de Condillac similarly stilled the body in order to fathom its sensations, thereby refashioning physicality into distinct parts with exact coordinates. But is there really such a thing as an expressionless face or an emotionless moment? Duchenne did not ask this question. He assumed that expressionlessness existed as both a state of being human and as a ground zero for the human face, his system of orthography built out from that assumption. He acknowledged that his project had certain shortcomings, however. He openly stated what was most obvious, that the electrode that passed the electric current onto his subjects' faces was also included in the photographs, right? He discussed the ways in which the lines on a face changed, sometimes according to age, and that the number and depth of the lines changed over time. The fact that his subjects ranged in age added this variable to his findings. But still, he differentiated between the fundamental lines of an expression and the lines that increasingly added to those as skin aged. The contingencies of taking a photograph produced further anomalies in his study: the amount and kind of light, the way a subject was lit from either from the bottom, harshly across the side of his face. Each changed the accuracy with which Duchenne was able to read lines onto a face. In addition, differences across subjects occurred because a subject's attention might have been drawn to some exterior object when the photograph was taken. Personal histories also complicated and worked against his search for precision. A subject could have been depressed. Mechanical variations occurred as well, because the strength of the electrical current could vary from image to image. Further, it was possible for the electric current running into the muscle to be so strong as to provoke additional movements, which we saw in an earlier slide. He asked, how do we distinguish these latter movements from those that are actually appropriate to the muscle excited? He wondered briefly whether the electric shock could be said to produce a sympathetic phenomenon, but he concluded, in order to dissipate doubts that could be raised by this objection, I chose as the principal subject for my experiments, what we said before, a man whose facial sensibility was poorly developed. The cobbler's facial neuralgia was his answer, and in fact his only answer, to whether there were ambiguities in his method, and he maintained, without providing proof, that localized muscular electricization does not provoke reflex contractions that complicate the isolated muscle action. The visible hands here recall yet another genealogy for Duchenne's text, one related obliquely to Taylorism. His images could be read as part and parcel of the disciplining medical gaze that Sekula previously so powerfully described. This gaze found pain wherever it looked and wrote the story of the subject as proceeding from a pathological potential. The authority of the medical gaze in that reading worked because it was its own cause and effect. Patients not only displayed symptoms, but learned to pose and produce, for example, later, the symptoms of hysteria. With this genealogy in mind, it is possible to look at the images and want to rescue the cobbler from the electric nodes and protect even his unfeeling, hi Priscilla, even his unfeeling skin. He seems abject, even in those images in which he is described as depicting the emotions surprised, fanciful, and pleasant-seeming. Bart described part of the work of any photographed as a wounding, a punctum. Photographic form in his telling was itself defined by its potential to wound the viewer, however temporarily. There is indeed something painful about looking at image after image of the cobbler or any of the other subjects' faces underneath electrodes, even allowing for the fact that this cobbler may not have felt any pain. Perhaps even more obviously, the photographic trace of the shock of electricity against the subject's skin, felt or not, limbs to what Walter Benjamin called the complex kind of training that the human sensorium underwent in modernity. Doan suggests through Benjamin again that in the 19th century, shock became a way of conceptualizing contingency. The images of the cobbler's face electrically shocked into expressions might be uncomfortable, painful for us even, perhaps precisely because they make explicit a constitutive condition of being modern to which we have all been subjected. Our emotional reactions have become conditioned and produced in part through shock by a technologically mediated world. Again, it remains an open question whether this is an image of fright. What's important is that, again, as a photography afforded Duchenne's expressions, for they were perhaps more rightly his expressions than his subjects, the illusion of being held still. And it was the illusion of isolation that, for Duchenne, transformed the lines of skin into orthographical markings. When Duchenne makes facial expressions into an orthography, into a discernible system of writing, he first and foremost decontextualizes them. Second, to designate expressions as an orthography collapses three dimensions of a face. The expressive lines lose their differentiation by depth or dimension in order to become orthographical. But in these images, since we see the electric nodes against the cobbler's brow and neck, and Duchenne's assistant sometimes placing the probes on these faces, we are reminded of space and necessarily that there is much about all of these faces that the photograph keeps us from perceiving. Despite all these markers of dimension and space, the idea of an orthography worked for Duchenne primarily because he was able to think of facial expressions as lines on the photographic surface. Duchenne's largely unspoken theorization of the camera relies on a conception of temporality as distinguishable instance. That is, the idea of facial expressions as an orthography only works when an emotional expression is understood as what happens at a discernible height of expression and in an instant. This sense of what an emotional expression is, I want to suggest, happens in Duchenne by way of his use of the camera. What's more, he needed to believe in the idea of a punctate instant specifically, in which a singular instant is separable from all other instants. He meant for his images to be read as representing an instant in time, as disconnected from other instants. Neither the moment before nor the moment after the expression caught in the photograph was part of the expression. More, the understanding of the images as orthography only worked in the case that the emotion had been captured, as though the face had been made to hold still for the briefest moment, which, at this moment in photography, was not the case. That is, the photograph was the expression only at the height, if that height could be imagined as the expression itself. His belief that his images were uncovering an orthography relied on this notion of expression, shaped by the camera, and relied on this idea of the instant, shaped by the working fiction that a photographic print was an instant of time. Duchenne himself remarked that one of the difficulties he ran into was that the height of an emotion could sometimes wear off during the course of exposing a plate. He also openly acknowledged that the electrode that passed the electric current onto his subjects' faces was also included in the photographs. He discussed the ways in which lines on a face changed according to age and the number and depth of lines that changed over time. Sorry. Still, he understood the contribution he made to the studies of facial expressions from the perspective of the study of muscular contractions. He imagined that his contribution of associating a muscular contraction with an emotion in a photograph would liberate artists from false interpretations and false representations of emotions. Another way of thinking about Duchenne is that through photography, he meant to make empirical knowledge of how emotions are physiological realities as much as they are occasions for poesis. Still, his idealization of what the camera gave him structured this understanding of what it was that his study proved. Physiognomic and physiological studies alike relied on the idea of a process between a soul's movement and the experience of an emotion and its expression. Duchenne understood expressions not as hypothetical outcomes of neurological pathways, nor even as movement or a process at all. A facial expression was the folds on a face, frozen in a photograph for Duchenne. The instant fictively implied by the photographic form facilitated this ability to think that what physiologists might see as part of a process could be shrunken to the expression at its height. While he avowed that his images documented a phenomenon, his findings were directly related to his ability to imagine that photographs were evidence of separable, unique instants in which an expression happened and through which it could be held. Duchenne pursued not only an orthography, but the instant where emotional expression, intention, and soul activation aligned. Duchenne's photographs aspired to a stopped moment that signaled full or complete expressions as a series of notations. Those notations in turn equated the lines of a facial expression with writings and the skin of the face with the surface of the photograph. But because Duchenne stimulated faces to elicit those contractions, the images he produced divorced the language of facial expressions from having to be spoken at all. His images unwittingly negated the personal in seeking an orthography. At the same time, they mobilized the tension between the soul's mysteries and the faith that science can decipher even human nature, that Charles Darwin's studies would later reanimate with another version of the photographic instant. Thank you.
Did Duchenne do anything? You showed his anatomical drawings and the photographs. Was there any evidence that he tried to extract these into like other kinds of graphic traces or work with the photographs, or did they appear? But so were they tools to think with in his laboratory that would be drawn upon, or is there a sense that these would just appear in his text, or we don't have access to them?
It does not seem like, so the book wasn't very popular, I shouldn't say that too. No, people were not terribly excited by the idea that we had a form of communication that was not under our control that could be easily discerned, right? So it didn't, and there was the issue of the subject's attractiveness. So although Darwin picks up a little bit later in the century on some of his images, the idea of an orthography itself doesn't make it much farther than Duchenne, or the idea that facial expressions are analogous to an orthography doesn't make it much farther than Duchenne. I think that's how I'll answer that.
Hi. Yes, Jen.
I'm sorry if this question's too historical.
No, I want it. Tell me.
So maybe this isn't exactly what you know about, but I'm just worried about actual, if there's any trace of reaction, like with this picture is of fright. It's certainly a frightening picture. And this era in Paris, the era of the spectacle, right? People are going to public morgues to look at bodies, which like this picture looks exactly like, I mean, he's alive, but these morgue pictures, right? And I mean, do you have any sense, and you said it wasn't popular, but of, I mean, was there any idea of like looking at people's reactions to?
Looking at people's reactions and photographing their own emotional reactions?
Or any sort of?
Really, I only found one account in a summary of an obscure medical journal that accounts for the fact that the study happened, but it didn't have a kind of description of what people said, which was disappointing. And I didn't look on the European case because the dissertation was American, so that's not terribly helpful. But that's as much as I found. And the Marta Brown, who's a historian of photography, who I think teaches in Canada, she has an account in a big general book about photography that talks about people's reactions to the ugliness of the subjects, and that's the most that I've been able. I mean, because so part of the reason, right, that it becomes a huge point is not just the fact of, or like French people are mean, but although no, I'm kidding. It is because he imagined his audience was not only medics and scientists, but his audience was artists. There's a couple of plates in the text that look like this. Some of them have the cobbler, some of them have the female subjects. And so, what's at work in the equivalence between the top and the bottom is his sense that his studies would replace the kinds of studies of emotional expression that artists had used before, which I mentioned part of them were drawings, many of them were in sculpture.
It's what you just said, where you said, you know, it kind of didn't go anywhere, no one picked this up.
Yeah.
Can you articulate why it's so important to you, or did you already have it?
I didn't, and that's my favorite kind of question because it's hard. Part of what Duchenne helps me think about is that the way that people are using photography conceptually varies. So he's important to me because he's important to showing that the form in the middle of the 19th century and the later part of the 19th century has a kind of malleability that affects scientific concepts. So he's important less for a kind of cultural shift that he himself initiates, and more about what he can elucidate, what he helps me elucidate about photography and science in the 19th century.
So are there other examples, maybe even in literary works or anywhere, are there other examples of the conceptual shift you're working with that you're putting in or going to put in contact with?
Sure. So the chapter that has not been written but is coming, get excited, is a chapter on Hawthorne that will be a kind of counter to a chapter on Wharton. And part of what the Hawthorne chapter is doing is, so the difference will be, the difference that I'm articulating will be about photographic technique, where in Hawthorne, he, I think, is articulating a kind of daguerreotypic imagination where part of the fear of emotional expression is that it is contagious. And the reason why I'm calling that a kind of daguerreotypic imagination is that the way that he describes how it is that characters catch expressions from one another is very much as though they are becoming a daguerreotype of the person that they're watching. So that's an unwritten but forthcoming chapter. And then the counterexample to that is, I think, Wharton's House of Mirth, where very much like the kind of coming out of a shift towards instantaneous cameras in the later 19th century. She being Lily Bart, is subject to the kind of scrutiny that I think Duchenne is unwittingly, right, articulating. And I say unwittingly because he doesn't think himself to be using photography as a tool that has conceptual ramifications, right? Which is different in Wharton, who is aware of how much risk Lily Bart's every movement is subject to. And I think that that sense of risk in the late 19th, early 20th century has a lot to do with the perceived threat of something like an instantaneous camera.
And I wonder if any of the neuroscience people here could say what Duchenne means to neuroscientists, or the notion of the contagion of expressions. I mean, the neuroscience engages in so many remarkable ways with facial expression, facial recognition, and can you foreground any of these?
Well, one particular...
Len White.
Hi, everybody. I encountered this text years ago while preparing a piece on facial expression. And one of the interesting achievements of this work was a rather extraordinary claim, and that is that some muscles that are used to express emotion are not under the control of the force of the will, I think is how Duchenne put it. And I think he was right about some of that, particularly the muscles around the eye, the orbicularis oculi. And about a century later, after Duchenne, actually more than a century later, we've come to understand a bit more about how the brain controls some of those muscles. So I think he was essentially right about several important of his ideas. You know, not right about everything. I'm sure, Kevin, you probably have more to say about that, but I think what was fundamentally correct is that the expressions of emotion are motivated by different parts of the brain than are many of our voluntary actions. And so that was, as you so beautifully laid out, one of his chief motivations.
Yeah, there's a dissociation between involuntary expression and voluntary expression. We now know the neural pathways that mediate those. They've been identified, you know, like you said, much later on. I think some of this work, I mean, has really set the ground for Paul Ekman's facial action coding system, which elaborated on a lot of this in looking at combinations of muscles that produce specific actions. And so that's a longstanding legacy of this work. It's also been used to try to look at cross-cultural identification of these expressions and to identify which emotions might be more basic and culturally shared. And I was also wondering about that, like what if we didn't have a language that allowed us to label that as terror expression? You know, would you still feel that kind of terror reaction to that photograph? You know, and so some of the argument is that, you know, we had some basic emotions that evolved that kind of transcend these linguistic differences across cultures that, you know, share that experience. So there's still also a lot of debate about this. So for example, some people still debate whether you have a genuine emotional reaction just by looking at one of these pictures or not. To what extent does it capture an emotional feeling state alone, or do you need that context of understanding, you know, what preceded before and after? You know, can you really get a genuine emotional reaction just from this kind of snapshot?
And when, can I ask you a question, or the neuroscientist in the room a question? When you, two questions. First question is, when you are talking about the reception of images of emotional expression, how often is the question, I guess, how often is the question one that's interested in mirroring? So, right, like mirroring, or having a kind of sympathetic response to the expression that's being expressed. So that's a how often question. And then the second question is, so we went to David Leopold's lab, and he was working with monkeys primarily, and he had started to, or some of his postdocs had started to think about using video instead of still images to get at the reading of emotional expressions in the monkey subjects. So my question, because the experiment that the students, Peter, who's sitting there, was one of them, that the students put together for the Bass Connections team used photographs as stimuli. So the afterlife of Duchenne, right, that I'm interested in is the fact of continuing to use the photographs as stimuli. So besides video, are there other methods that neuroscientists, and this is for anybody, right, who knows, are there other methods that neuroscientists are using to get away from the kinds of conceptual shortcomings that come with thinking of the photograph of a face as itself the expression of an emotion?
There's a lot to that. So,
yeah.
In my own lab, we're using things like morphing software to create kind of subtle expressions, or using videos where we get, you know, a lot of these are very exaggerated, prototypical kind of examples of what that expression would look like. There's been a lot of question about, well, do people really experience that kind of terror very often in their life that would be expressed by that particular image, you know? And so there's some question about whether focusing on these very extreme examples is really is the best way to study how emotions unfold naturally in normal interactions. So that's one thing. But yes, using things like morphing software or video software.
I don't know what morphing software is.
Basically, we can take, for example, you have the neutral pose of the actor, and then you have this pose, which is the extreme endpoint. Mm. And we can actually take fiducial markers on the different muscles, and then we can morph those to create blended expressions or more subtle expressions. They're artificial expressions, but this is, you know, something that I think scientists are moving towards, to look at, you know, more subtle changes or the dynamics of the change. So, for example, so in my own work, I've shown that when you morph a face to go from neutral to fearful, it gives you a much stronger response in these emotion processing regions than just the picture of the still itself. So we think that by focusing just on these still images, we're not engaging the neural system in the way it's normally engaged.
Because of anticipation.
Because we're attuned to the dynamics of the expression and what happened before it. And so it's those changes in expression that the system is really tuned towards that is lacking in this depiction.
That's fascinating.
So you said earlier in the beginning about kind of the challenge of ever really sharing or entering someone else's emotional world. And just kind of going off of that question about like what is like relevant about this to you, I was kind of building off of that and listening to your talk and the kind of idea of the ability to capture, and just wanted to know if there are other things around relevance or meaning that you draw out of like the attempt to kind of break the face down or expression down into something that can be easily legible. And if you think that has any relevance for us.
So part of the motivation, I think, behind the project is a kind of a concern with how, despite regimes of intense visuality and increased surveillance made possible by technologies like photography or video cameras in the later 19th century or now, what kinds of senses of personhood both the 19th century moment forged, despite the trackability of your expressions of emotions, your activities, your day-to-day casual utterances, that's like the beating heart of the project, is that how do folks conceive of individuals, people, some sense of sanctity and dignity amidst, right, the sort of obsessive and upsetting documentation of everyday life. And I think I probably don't have to say very many more words to have the relevance to the early 21st century moment be evident, right? That like the, without really realizing it, ironically, since it's about involuntariness, but without realizing it, I sort of wrote a prehistory to our present moment in our own obsession with accounting for, documenting, photographing, videotaping, snapping all of life, And so the question still is, what kind of sense of privacy, what kind of dignity, what kind of selfhood can we articulate outside of the trackability and the reception of the trackabilities of being?
I wonder how you compare this to the work of Jean-Martin Charcot, the photos from the Salpêtrière of hysterical women. And particularly, there's a really interesting question of the, when he was photographing women sort of performing hysterical crises, they often actually apparently were epilepsy patients. And yet they also were sort of able to behave in these, they were able to simulate seizures even when they were not having them. So it turns out that basically under the context of being sort of co-observed, that these hysterical and epileptic patients ended up creating a kind of shared register of behaviors for the camera and for the medical observers who thought that they were seeing this particular type of convulsive hysteria.
So part of what's very cool about Duchenne is that not only are his techniques still evident in someone like Paul Ekman and the people who disagree with Paul Ekman and social psychology, but Charcot was his student. So the fact of something, yeah, it's cool. So the fact of images like this, the fact of him positioning only his female subjects in narrative and explicitly performative postures, I think exactly prefigures something like Charcot's patience. And the, like, what's further cool is that most of the, I wish I'd taken more to give you all, but most of the times when this particular female subject is photographed, she is always holding a breast, which doesn't, has very little to do with what's happening narratively in Macbeth at the time, or the, like in the scene that the, supposedly the photograph illustrates. And the kinds of, I say that to say that it is exactly a kind of prefiguration of like the convulsions that the woman would perform, that his patients would perform as hysterics.
Yeah, it makes you realize how much early neuroscience was engaged with the spectacular. Mm-hmm. Which at this point is so hard to align with a kind of, you know, studiously neutral, defensively neutral scientific discourse of empiricism. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for using the word spectacular. That's going to be really useful for me.
When you were talking about your dissertation, there was a focus on the unintentional as some sort of index of authenticity. Mm-hmm. And I was curious how these are involuntary movements might play into that, because you could just ask somebody to smile and then check what muscles have moved or photograph them after you ask them to do this. So what kind of authenticity do you think, what's the play there between authenticity?
Yeah, that's a beautiful question. So I think part of how Duchenne might answer the question is that the way that he was trying to get to a kind of empirical map of muscles necessitated the specific articulation of muscle by muscle. So the two, meaning that he needed to make sure that it was that muscle that was contracting in the smile, in the smirk, this is flirting. in the specific action that he was photographing. So what he did, and I feel like I maybe did this a little rushed at the end, but in making the photographs entirely involuntary, something that he wrestles with, right, but like not in any serious way, he sacrifices authenticity, but also makes the involuntary the locus of it. So it's sort of, it's playing both sides in the work. Thanks. Thank you, Duchenne, also.
You've heard the term like angry resting face, which is an interesting term because it conveys a kind of sense of a lack of expression as an intentionality, right? Mm-hmm. And so I wondered, on the series of articles I would click on the internet when I was wasting time, written by you, would be a series of articles, A, about just what Duchenne or your study writ large can tell us about that kind of contradiction in terms. Mm-hmm. B, the idea of like a gift that goes on replay of an expression.
Mm-hmm.
And C, how, I mean, because he's doing a little, it's like a little bit of a precursor of a selfie in a weird way,
uh-huh.
right? So like, what is the intentionality and levels and layers between one photographing oneself of intentionality expression, right? In that kind of way. So I don't know if there was a question in that, but just more so, I think that it speaks to some really interesting ways in which we use facial expression and technology today.
So one thing I want to say that jumped immediately to mind was that I think, I don't know, I mean, the idea that I was trying to get at with thinking about how he's mechanizing the face both through Taylorism and through some sort of articulation of like the shock of modernity is part of, I think that's part of a delight that we've learned with delight about and in terms of repetition. So that for me helps to articulate what is the one that goes over and over? The GIF, yeah. GIF, is it GIF? It helps to, no, but seriously, I think it helps to articulate the kind of delight that we have with that kind of repetition, because it puts, this would be my contention, that it puts us in touch with some kind of, some sense that we have about how mechanized and habituated our bodies are around and in terms of technology in the present moment. And that's like, that's the fun that we get to experience by watching someone, you know, or even, right, like the sort of pre-GIF analog would be like that skit where, where Lucy is like in the factory and she's, you know, like, yeah, exactly. So like the failure of that is the kind of zany moment in I Love Lucy that we enjoy the opposite of in the GIF. The other bitchy resting face.
But like there's like an angry resting face, right? So
yeah.
It's like the whole idea is that like you're invoking this emotion, so then the rest of the time there has to be an absence of this emotion,
mm-hmm.
right? An angry resting face is like the absence of emotion as emotion.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
But I think that, but doesn't like, I feel like something like angry resting face or bitchy resting face gets to what other apparatuses of perception are at play when you look at someone, right? So it's not just about what shape their face is making, but it's about who they are. It's about, are they a woman? Are they black? Are they, right? Like, those are playing into what, who gets designated as having such a resting face. I think, yeah, Priscilla.
I keep thinking about something, having just taught Darwin, again, noticing for the first time and sort of thinking, I think, about your work, that he talks about natural selection or nature as scrutinizing the whole world and capturing those moments where, so in other words, there's actually in Darwin this really interesting language that seems to me to dovetail with a lot of what you're talking about.
Mm.
And I don't know if I'm making too much of it or not, but
no,
the idea of nature scrutinizing
is
really interesting.
So part of what that helps me articulate, maybe not for you all, but for myself and for the chapter, will be how to make the transition between the kind of punctate instant that I think Duchenne is really interested in and the different sense of time that Duchenne is articulating, right? So the idea of a capturing that's not in fact even about a present or an instant, but in fact, the first picture that comes to mind is like a wide net that can capture the entirety of evolutionary time is the kind of capturing
which is a really interesting verb.
Nature scrutinizes.
It's weird because he doesn't often ascribe intentionality.
And in fact, it's right like a couple of paragraphs after he says, people think that natural selection means I'm giving agency to nature. I'm not.
Mm-hmm.
Nature scrutinizes the word, you know.
Yeah.
That's what you're talking about.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Really elucidate a lot of what may be going on there.
Yeah.
It's really interesting.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Produced by Duke University, online at duke.edu.